Okie dokie.
All right, you people. So, I asked you guys to look into this whole thing of that I'm calling a proof of concept demo. It is purposefully kind of a loose set of requirements. I didn't want to, you know, say you have to do this because, you know, or you have to do it in a certain way because, quite honestly, I mean, your projects are so different, or your ideas are so different that I just wanted to actually just leave more of the flexibility for you guys. So we have talked about it. I've gathered up, like, your information from your original ideas, which I, you know, can link out to. And then also the stuff that we worked on last time, that were here 2 weeks ago, like, you know, these original groups of just like ideas or notes that you jotted down on these documents. So I have them all linked together so we can refer to them and kind of have a, what I hope is a dynamic discussion as you kind of just put it out there, like, yes, we can do it, or no, we hit a brick wall. And a brick wall does not necessarily mean that your idea is dead. It just means we here can actually talk about it and come up with maybe some ideas to keep your idea alive. Anyways, the focus has been on these four, I don't know if you can see that up there, the four ones at the top there that I highlighted in yellow. That is not set in stone. These are just the ones that we've started to process through. If anyone wants to re-engage on another idea, or even still yet, introduce a new concept, a new idea, the door is still open, so it's up to you guys to assert yourself if you want to, you know, if you want to do that. So, actually, does anyone have anything before we start with actually talking about these top four? Anything new that you want to insert into the process? Or let's just stay with these four right now. Yes. Oh, okay. Yeah. Sure. 5-10 minutes. That's actually a good idea to kind of regroup and get yourself together here, because what I'm going to do is ask everyone to, like, you know, kind of not do a formal presentation, but definitely come on up here, show us what you got, and yeah, I'll stop making those references. but take a few minutes. I'll put on some background music. So just going to chat amongst yourselves. Make sure you got something to come up here with, and I'll restart in just a couple minutes.
Thank you.
You guys need a couple more minutes or good? How you doing? Good? Alright. Let's rock and roll. Now I'll just kind of turn it to you guys to say, okay, who wants to go first? Keeping in mind that it is a very loose kind of thing. It's like, and I'm not gonna grade your presentations or anything like that. We just gotta keep the ball moving forward in terms of these ideas. So randomly, I will just, yeah, okay, thank you very much. How do you want to proceed? Do you have some slides or anything to blow on the screen here?
We have a tech demo and I brought my adapters.
Aha, adapters are good. All right, let me make room for you here. So it's HDMI, they also have VGA.
HDMI, sorry.
Okay, let me get this stuff on here. And just kind of leave that here for you. So there's that. So do start, at least I'll ask you, you know, to start by regrounding us in the idea, what we've talked about so far. And actually, as you go there, I'll refer back to some of the notes that we were taking from last time we got together.
Okay.
About like some of the things that we consider possible barriers or trouble areas that you had written down earlier. So have at it, but like I said, start off by reminding us, what was it called?
So what we're working on is Luke. It's kind of like a bot that works on Facebook or Twitter. It pulls tweets from the applications and runs a sentiment analyzer on it and spits back out data to see like how good of a person you are, your Twitter post, okay. For the tech demo, let me just run it. Nodemon bin www. And we're good to go. Cool. So essentially each running circle would be a different user. Your circle would shrink, speed up, and enlarge. depending on like how mean or nice or joyous your tweet was. Connecting that to what we have is a bit tricky, so it would take more time than the time that we were allowed to do this tech demo. But what we do have is that we connect the Twitter API, and we can search anything we want and pull the latest 20 tweets. I just searched Donald Trump, and that's Donald Trump. But you can change it to whatever thing you want. Taco, save, application. Rerun it, and now you have 20 tweets about tacos. So we connected like the API. You can pull from Twitter. So that's the biggest tech accomplishment we have for this.
Okay, so yeah, that's right. The ability to access some or any social media platform, search on trending items,
yeah,
and then somehow that relates to the dots. Now, is there an algorithm there that actually has meaning between the movement and the colors and the sizes?
Right now, the movement and colors are just random. If we have more time, we would connect everything together, but since it's a bit difficult, we just did like a randomized version, like this is what it would look like essentially.
I get it. You started saying that before, so okay, I get it now. So do you have any preliminary ideas of how to represent what comes up in the feed in terms of actually what are the attributes? There's size, color,
size,
speed, or yeah, motion, or
size, color, speed. It would all be subjective in how we represent it.
I'm
assuming like growing large and changing red would be anger. Getting small and going blue would be your timid. Just like simple features that like people should identify with.
Yeah. So there's some correlation that you will put together.
Yes.
And you're not so much concerned about the ability to, I mean, you got the data. You've got the ability to do these things. What do you call those?
The circles?
Nodes?
Nodes.
Okay, I've dubbed those nodes. So the technology, or just basically the code, the algorithm to connect the two, not a concern. You know that's work, but
yeah, it just
you can do it.
I talked to you like on Wednesday. I'm using Node.js right now. It's been pretty cool. I like it. I just have to run a socket between the server JS and the client JS, and then I can shove the Twitter data through to the client.
Yeah.
It's just I didn't do that. It was kind of hard.
That's okay. No, but still though. By the way, you know you're kind of setting the bar kind of high here for everyone else here. I mean that's basically it, and that would be a awesome digital media studies project. You know, demonstration. It is definitely digital. Obviously, it's media. And it's a study of things, so it's not necessarily, which is, by the way, I just kind of want to harp on a point here. Okay, so how do you monetize this? It's like, we don't care at this point. I mean, you can go figure that out if that's where you want to go, or it could evolve into something else.
I think just be Facebook and run ads on it.
Yeah, it's something like that. And Facebook, of course, is doing so fine these days. But actually, that's a good example. It's like, when Zuckerberg put together FaceMash, I mean, he didn't really have a monetization model at that time, and that's not the point. Obviously, he did figure it out, and that led to some other issues, but that's not part of what's on your shoulders for this capstone project. So yeah, just doing something, demoing it, actually putting it together for the actual capstone project. Whatever it is that you guys do, that's all that's important. And from my own impression, from capstone projects I've seen that have gone before, the idea of trying to do something that this will make me $1 billion is usually the thing that brings some of these good ideas to its knees. So again, it's like if you just focus on, you want the A right now, so do focus on that, and that's all you got to do. So it's not rocket science. It's computer science. So that's good. Let me just kind of ask you guys now to think about like questions or concerns that you have on this particular capstone idea, because again, keeping in mind, not all the capstone ideas are actually going to be adopted next semester. Some of you may actually be end up working on this stuff like that. So having questions now would, you know, like getting them answered, or at least having us discussion about them would be a good thing.
Hi. Okay. So is this run? Is this running locally right now or on a server?
It's running locally using Node.js.
Okay. And for, so you have this product, right? And would everybody see the same image, or would you have something unique based on what, like, would they be able to, like, query Twitter to, like, have a custom map, or would they, everybody see the same map on the same keywords?
So that's actually something I was thinking about. Mm-hmm. Right now, it's based on, like, you query it, and then it sets up the nodes based on that. I would kind of like it if, like, users would log in and they would pull their stuff individually, so, like, it would be, like, kind of a group communication thing, but that would require me to ask permission for their user data.
Yeah.
And that's kind of
that also
annoying.
Involves kind of like a complicated database.
Yes. So just querying Twitter and then it sets up no randomly, that's better in my opinion. It's easier to do, less privacy restrictions.
Yeah.
Okay. Stand near this microphone here.
Yep.
And hello. Is this all you at this point? Have you been able to incorporate some ideas and some work, or do you have some ideas of how to get involved? Because, by the way, keeping in mind, actually, I'm sorry, let me ask you guys a question. Because I don't know how much Jarvis or who is it now, Ashenfelder, has told you about what you'll be doing in the capstone?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Okay, so a lot of it is more than just the project itself, but actually the promotion of it.
Oh,
like,
right.
Basically, think, yeah, marketing. So there's going to be a lot of time and resources for creating videos of you guys and your capstone project, and creating a poster, I think, is one of the other requirements. You know, if you remember when we've had the seniors do their events,
yeah.
They've got a lot of marketing materials and other, like, kind of handouts and stuff like that. That's on you guys to create. So not everyone is actually working on the code and the technology, if that's, you know, the type of project it is, but you also need people that are gonna work on the promotion and marketing materials of these capstone ideas too. So I'm surprised I'm the one that's telling you that, but there you go. Any other questions specifically for Luke? Oh, and by the way, is that gonna be the name, or that's just the technology that you're using?
Oh, it was the name I came up in like 5 minutes, so probably not, but...
Oh, right, okay. Any other questions for actually the team? Who's on the team so far?
Thank you.
There you go. Gerardo?
If you would. The top of the
You had a question, right? No, I did not. I just said, like, who was in the team, and I'm on the team.
Oh.
I did not have a question. Sorry.
I apologize. Any questions
for Famous or any other things that we want to talk about on this?
Who wants to pull down the Twitter feed?
Oh, yeah. Can you do that right now?
I mean, I could if someone gave me the Twitter ID, but...
that'd be too scary or creepy. All right, let's move on to another one.
Actually, let me get back to my list here.
So we did that. We also have Virtual Zen for children with disabilities, and the Spark one, and of course, Food Trucker app. Who wants to go next before I, oh, thank you very much. So Virtual Zen for children with disabilities, and by the way, if you start coming up with working titles besides, you know, what we originally started calling it, let me know.
Will do.
Come on, give it a shake. Is there any buttons? Oh, here you go.
Okay.
All right, had to wake up. It's kind of low res. Is it supposed to look like that?
I don't know. It's probably because it's normally used to being set up to, like, my monitor.
Yeah.
So the settings are probably weird. Anyways, so our main concern is I want to be able to have people play multiplayer through an online network, and the software that I'm using, which is GameMaker Studio 2.0, I wasn't sure if it was able to do that because it's kind of like a lesser used, more recent software. But there is, so that's good. So I didn't have time to actually create a whole new game, because if you've ever created a game, that just takes forever. But what I did find was this code that gives you step-by-step of what to implement in all the objects and where to implement it. So this stuff's pretty like in depth. And then I also found, this is just somebody's
tutorial.
Yeah, but at the very end,
server.
Just show like a minute.
Join the server with Zach. All right, so now cool. Let's create another client. Bob. So you can see Bob. And if we hit Bob, we get an error. Shoot.
So this is like a 5-step tutorial video. So it's only like 3, so they feel like the errors of if you can disconnect or if you hit people or whatever. But that just shows kind of the ability to do that stuff through. Obviously, he's just doing it on his own computer right now, but you're joining a network, so you could also do that on multiple computers. It's just love to take a video of that. But it's nice to figure out that that can be done.
Yeah.
And then it would just be implementing it, which looks like it's a decent amount of work, but it's well documented. Mm-hmm. So that's always good.
So, yeah.
I was going to say some important things I found like while researching with kids with disabilities, that important things to convey through the technology is that it's important to have that teacher and like student interaction, especially since some students with disabilities have, obviously they all have different degrees and levels of their disability and different types, so it's important to be sensitive to that, and having some sort of technology where the teacher has access and the student has access and they can interact. And it's important because it's to make the child feel like they're independent and they have something that's their own. And they feel like they're still a part of like the classroom, still a part of like, you know, have their peers as well, so.
And e-learn and classroom I was researching was Google Classroom. It has very interactive like platform. Like the teacher is the one who usually makes the classroom, and then all students can see it. And in the classroom, students can always like, they can always comment on each other's work, and they can always like, whenever they ask questions or whatever, it's kind of like similar to Slack too. And also there's a part of it where parents can see the progress of students if they use, like ask the teacher to join the class.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that'd actually be a nice feature, because I remember actually back in my day, there was like in classrooms and around the time like CD-ROMs first became like a thing, and that schools were buying computers with CD-ROMs, and the typical thing, which was a terrible thing, and you know, classrooms mostly stopped doing this, which was to load up a classroom computer. You load up some game which had, you know, supposed to have some educational value, and you stick a kid on it, and now you can just forget them. And there would be, it was basically like a babysitter, you know, that supposedly had some educational value. But the idea was that to disconnect the kid and just leave them with the computer. And what you're saying there actually makes perfect, is actually the great, you know, thing that was missing from that whole model was, it's actually using the computer but still tying people together in real time. That's fabulous. I wish the teachers from, I don't want to say like from the 70s and 80s, really got their head around that and realized what that was such a mistake, and what they needed was more stuff like that. You know, something where there would be the ongoing interaction, online interaction, but it's still interaction, and then you get the benefits of like, you know, remote interaction and stuff like that, and observation. So the stuff you're saying sounds really good. The pieces and parts that you're saying, so there's the ability to create a game, work in a collaboration environment. Were there any other technologies or things that were part of it that you were gonna look into?
We didn't look into audio, but I think audio is an important thing, I think.
I'm sorry, what?
Audio.
Oh, yeah.
So whether it be like some sort of like sounds or like, you know, within the game, I think that's important to consider, but that's something that you'd probably have to do research with each disability and figure out what's necessary for that.
Yeah, I mean, as far as implementing, like, if decide to use GameMaker Studio 2, because I've used that before in different class, like, it has the ability to, like, implement all of those things. So, like, the networking was the one thing I wasn't sure about.
Yeah.
So it can implement that, but it's easy to implement sound. You just have to, like, create the sound in a different software. Same with, like, the art stuff. Like, it has the ability to create art within the game, but it's not great. So, like, if you can create artwork in, like, a different, and then bring it in, it normally looks better.
Yeah. Okay.
But it has the ability to, like, bring all of those things together within the software.
Yeah, just a matter of next burning questions in my mind is, like, how robust is it? How easy is it to actually put together working, you know, working games that you can demo and put together with, like, just a small group of you by the time, before you graduate, basically?
For next semester?
Yeah.
Like, this semester?
No, for next semester.
Oh, I mean, we did it in a semester when I took Joe's class last semester. I mean, we put together a whole working game.
Oh, okay.
So.
Yeah, so you, so just a basic game, but without the networking part, right?
Without the networking, but I mean, our game had some complex coding things that took me, like, forever, so it's definitely possible to take time, basically, but everything's pretty well documented, and I feel like I have the capabilities, it's just the time.
Okay, if I can ask you guys, dig deep and think of things or concerns or kind of building on the idea. Any thoughts? I think we're good to go. Any other? Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we're supposed to. Yay. Go team. All right, two down. Let's see, Spark or Truck? Guys, you have to battle to the death. You're closer. Is there anything you can bring up?
I think it's fine. Do you have an issue?
Oh, yeah. HDMI or VGA.
Do you know what
there you go. Okay, so this is Spark. It was the creative tool with social media stuff. Actually, just a couple words, maybe.
Beginning, just to refresh your memory of. This is the thing, the challenges, right? Or is that another one?
So what were the technology concerns? And I know you and I, we exchanged some emails, but why don't you put that out there for everyone?
So, one sec. So Spark was, again, the creative prompt, sort of creative tool, social media type, where it would give you either daily, weekly, or monthly sort of prompt, and then various creators from visual artists, musicians, any kind could post their sort of responses to the same prompt. It would be like an interesting sort of, you know, idea sharing way. People who, you know, want to sort of exercise their creative muscle, so to speak, but then don't really have a way to do that effectively. This is for them. So our big and kind of relatively simple technical, I guess, hurdle to find was making or at least finding a platform that could support various types of media and then have it all be visible, stored in a database.
By multiple users.
So we explored various third-party options since we felt that was like easier. It seemed like the sort of thing where there's already so many people doing that. It's like you might as well just see what other people are doing. What we found is the answer is you definitely can do it. Asterisk the answer is money, basically. All these sites like WordPress can do what we're asking to. But if you give them money, they'll do it, and if it's free, they won't give you the storage space, is sort of what it comes down to. With WordPress specifically, You could post all these, like, you know, images, video, audio. You could post them, but you couldn't let other users post on your website without plugins, and the plugins are only accessible once you start into a paid plan.
Which we could talk about.
Yeah. And then we found a, what we could do just was zero, like, most we could do was $0, basically, for the party platform. But we found this, like, very basic form creator website. And it works kind of okay. It does images really well. But videos, I think it can do, but they're usually too big for you to be allowed to post them. It's the sort of thing where you can increase the storage space with money. I think the biggest hurdle with this specific platform is audio. You can upload audio relatively easily, but there's no in-app music player. You literally, like, have to click on the link and it, like, auto-downloads the MP3 and it plays on your own device, which is, like, okay, like, but it's not what I was thinking about. I was thinking there'd be, like, a press play button to play, you know. And there are plugins for this, but there wasn't one that allowed you to do that. Finally, there was one that allowed you to just, like, when you went on the site, it just played music automatically, but I don't know, it's a funny feature. But anyway, so yeah, I think we can do it. Like, I think there's a lot of proof that it's possible. I'm not sure if there's a lot of proof that it's free. I'm not sure if we were to try to do it from scratch, if even then it would still be free, because it just seems like a storage issue.
Right.
And regardless of how well it's programmed, the storage is just, like, a separate thing entirely.
But using, like, university research, like Bluehost or something, and, like, building your own app or own website would, like, completely clear the hurdle in the first place. It's definitely possible to do.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. There might be some other ways, just, again, in the spirit of brainstorming, you know, it's like just to do a capstone, you know, a capstone project. Even though we talked about, like, that it would be definitely better to keep this all in-house under the domain and not leverage, like, stuff like YouTube and things like that. YouTube is pretty accessible. I mean, you can pretty much wrap YouTube, even though it would still have the branding of YouTube in there, like within, you know, a frame or something like that. That might be good enough just to kind of show and get the flavor of this idea of the community, where people can put their stuff there, but basically do it through your interface.
I was looking at other forums, and that's basically what they did. They had, like, a YouTube, and it was just, it wasn't even, like, the link to YouTube.
It was embedded.
It was embedded, exactly. So you could just press play, and it worked like that. Mm-hmm. So I think that would definitely be enough to at least get the flavor of it, and then if we were to move forward, then we, you know, be another story.
Yeah. The key thing there, I think, if you were to go down that path, it would still be you're building your own website, and you wouldn't have to worry about the storage and serving and streaming of digital media, because that could be handled by, you know, those free services. But then the hard part becomes building the website and building an interface where the embed codes are, like, automated, where basically you could have an interface that would take someone through, where you don't want it too disjointed, where you know, you go to YouTube and you get your embed code and bring it to our website, but actually build that whole process and automate it in your website.
I definitely think it's possible. Maybe you can automate.
WordPress already does it. Put a lead to link in a WordPress, like, blog, it just, like, embeds the video automatically.
Yeah, no, I think there is a thing. It is a matter of cobbling together a lot of plugins, not necessarily, you know, for pay plugins, but I think that's where the work would be.
Yeah.
And a lot of it has to do with leveraging existing technology, which is awesome, and your focus would be mostly on the interface and actually building, you know, what does it take to build a community and stuff like that. And I know courses where you can, you know, supposed to learn that stuff. So, any other things, concerns there?
Not really. I think it's definitely possible.
To do a capstone, if this was to go on to become an actual one of the capstone projects, and then to kind of, like, jump ahead, like, in the future, it's like, okay, so what would it take to actually do one of those senior presentations? So you would need users, you would need content,
How would you get there?
I know a lot of people who are like artists in creative spaces, so they see me be like during this whole process, we'd be like, coming up with prompts and posting them to people that we know.
Yeah.
Saying, come up with something for this, and like have them, we'll be stockpiling like content for this like the entire semester, the entire project building semester.
I think I said it in the first group of content meeting, but again, like I think the biggest hurdle is going to be just like the inherent joy that people get from actually experiencing like, I put this in this work, and I did this, and this other person did that. It's cool how it's kind of different, but it's also kind of similar in some ways. We definitely do know a lot of artists personally, which is nice, and I think that's a good start. Like, I think once you have some people doing it, then more people will be like, this looks really cool. How do I get involved? Oh, you just do the thing.
The key thing, excuse me for interrupting, but that's exactly it, is that I think the focus for this project would be how do you bootstrap it to the point where it starts to take off by itself. And by knowing people and also promotion. So like I was telling you, it's like, you guys are gonna have to, not just focus on the actual, thing that you're building, but also you have to promote it and build posters and cards and stuff like that. That would actually be one of the primary components for a project like this, is promoting it, because you need to bootstrap it to get enough people into it so other people will get into it.
Like technologically it's like maybe not simple but sort of it's already like it's not new particularly. Just like the idea that it's sort of like creating something out of nothing. Like if you just put like enough idea in someone's head that like, oh, let's make some art together, like I think that's a neat
It's intriguing. It's a alluring concept. The social media aspect, I don't even want to say social media. I mean, it's so we beat it to death. But I mean, it's community building. It's it's interesting. Once you touch it, if you're already interested in art and seeing other people's art, who wouldn't want to play with it? If it was a nice interface, it was easy. You didn't have to come up a learning curve. You just get in there and start doing it. And there's other people that are already there. So that would be the challenge. And the fact that
to other DMS classes and other like studio art classes, because there are a lot of like essay classes where you have to like do something, post on a blog. So we can do is like, hey, there's a student group using this app, and then it's like an art-based app. So go and do something for this, and that's
the
assignment.
There's also the Creative Art Club, I think.
The only idea there's clubs here.
I just heard of it the other day too. But reaching out to them, I'm sure would be
We have a lot of avenues to get.
This I'm getting excited about this, because here too, I think of, again, I keep on saying this, is that there are so many capstone projects that I've seen that have come before you guys, where they hit these, as I say, these brick walls, and it's usually because they try to achieve too much on the computer science side. They're trying to create some new program to read people's minds or something like that, which sounds like a great computer science project, but this is, of course, DMS. And this is what DMS is all about. Taking, it's more the digital media, not just a, computer science capstone, which there are none, but you know what I mean. So any other thoughts, questions, or things you want to bring up? Because this might sound intriguing to one of you guys.
Jester,
that
you're thinking of a
question? No. Okay.
That's his face.
Once,
twice.
And then
as many as you want.
More just like a curiosity thing, but as far as like the prompts, like how do you guys like plan on like coming up with those? Like, is it just going to be like what you think of at the time, or is it going to be based on like user feedback, or?
I think we'll be based on a lot of things. Something that I want to do is sort of research more into like how Creative Cloud works. I think that would be a good way to start prompts. I also want to have not make prompts, but suggest prompts, and we can sort of go from there. I think, especially if there's a lot of users, and you can do be like search like key phrases kind of. There's like a pattern, but it comes from the user submission, comes from us, whoever's working on it. I think I'd rather just do it by hand than have some sort of computer randomly generate them, so I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, I would think that like letting the users have at least some kind of way in would be nice, because then like that differentiates it from like those like prompt books you can buy. It's like, okay, if you're just going to give me a prompt every week, I could just buy this $5 book and like have my prompts already. So
considering the frequency with which you want to suggest prompts to be daily, weekly, bi-weekly, or monthly, like it wouldn't be that much effort to have one prompt for every 24 hours.
Yeah.
You know, any like AI generating.
But also, like, it can just be like submitted, because you don't want to work with the prompt, you know. Like, not that it would be your prompt, but you know what I mean. Like,
yeah.
But definitely user input would be important, especially since it's all about user input for every other aspect of the site. It would feel weird to not have that as part of the
yeah.
process.
Yeah, it is.
Just real quick, because you brought up like you know creativity and stuff like that. And years ago, actually, I was working with a bunch of people who were writing, doing a lot of projects on exactly trying to define creativity, and you know trying to net it out of like what is the simplest way to describe this this concept that we all kind of know what that means, but we don't really know how to get there. It just kind of magically happens. And the result of it, long story short, is one way to bootstrap it is simply taking two things that have nothing to do with each other and mushing them together. And the classic example, and they wrote a lot about it, is the words airport, lobster, something like that, is just like so bizarre and so random. But I mean, it's like, yeah, airport, lobster, go. You know, and it actually it also turned into a great name for a band. But but those are the kind of things. It's like two things, and you can use random generators to give you spit out a bunch of you know random words put together, two words, three words, and I've seen them online, and stuff like that is a great way to get started. And then the social aspect, like you know, pretty much you just let the people beat their path. You know, to as many, you know, how many people think this is interesting, and they start beating a path towards the best ones, and then they become your prompts,
yeah.
You know, to the ones that are most intriguing. And even that process could be an interesting part of the entire experience. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, no, I'm pretty charged up about this as well, too. So, yeah, good luck.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, cheer, everyone. Yay! Come on, give it up for us. And now, last but not least, the team that has all the rest of the class and participating in.
Was it called? Not Food Truck, Trucker App, it was Curb Stompers. The Curb Stompers. All right, come up and give us some shtick. All right, make them all stand here.
Do we really all?
I think we should. It's been such a team effort so far.
Do you want to hold hands
up there too? No, you got to perform the chant, you know, the curve chant. Yeah, you have to have a step, like curb stomp, you know. Introduce it. So, come on, get closer because you're all friends. And yeah, do remind me what are the critical pieces. Hopefully that'll wake up.
Yeah, it's just Michael and the ladies.
So I should.
Oh yeah.
I need the light over there.
Oh jeez. What were the concern? I mean, so it was the food trucker app. Food trucks are awesome. We all want to find them, possibly order from them. So what were some of the challenges besides getting that screen to work? What are the other technical challenges that you were thinking about?
So despite having the main components of this will be GPS feature, obviously because you have to track tracks, as well as a database feature. So those are kind of the technologies we will be talking about. Once this fires up a little bit. So we don't have a working demo, which is due to time constraints, but we are planning with the like Swift model in mind, right? So like we're not really thinking to Android, but more to iOS at the time. Partially because I don't have a program in Swift, not Android. But in a moment we shall see. Hopefully, yeah. We're just going to talk about it without visuals.
Or just turn the your Mac around.
Pass it around the room.
Pass it, yeah, there we go.
Is it working?
All right, maybe we just talk about it.
Maybe just turn it around.
What?
I grouped the DMS majors in order to figure it out. Oh, yeah. How many DMS majors does it take to put a PowerPoint presentation on a display?
It happens in computer science, too. It's like 5 minutes for like 8 PhD students to make that.
I worked IT, too.
Oh,
yeah.
It
didn't
matter.
I
think
you need to work a little more.
Would you like my adapter?
Okay, we can just turn it.
All right, yeah.
Okay.
All right, so.
Can everyone see?
Can everyone see that nice logo? Cool. So, core tracking technology. So the big component of this is the tracking technology itself. So, Swift has this awesome thing called core location, which is something I've kind of dabbled with a little bit before, but this is the ability for an application to basically talk to Swift, essentially be like, hey, I'm here, hey, let's get there. This is the main like GPS of the application. In addition to that, there's a Google Maps SDK that you can integrate. So we have two options tied up with the GPS that we can try to build it all with core location. But if we need a little bit more like razzle dazzle or like be a little bit better like the map feature, we can automatically integrate the Google Maps API. Sorry, SDK. And I've also kind of dabbled with that before. You can also like change icons with that really easily. So instead of just having a little like Google Maps pin, we just change it to curb or truck and have a nice like mapping feature. That's all very doable. The second key component is the database system. So we need, from our brainstorming, we need at least a minimum of 3 databases, which we can kind of interconnect a little bit. One for the truck itself, menus, locations, hours, when the truck's running, if it's active or not, where it is, all that. Second database for customers per truck, so each truck can have a list of customers with customer info, number of visits, etc. This can be used for marketing in the future as well. So if you have a frequent customer, depending on what we do, like on their social media, we can figure out how to like, market to that customer and like customers better. In addition to that, like it's good to keep track of who's purchased everything versus just like having credit cards. And then the last database that we most absolutely need is user accounts. So this is from not the truck end, this is from the user using the app from like the customer end. So presumably the app will have two sides. One is like the truck registering at the truck, you can track the truck and then like send that data out. And then you have the user end, which accesses that data and you can make your choice on how to get to each food truck from there. So that user's account data will be stored in a separate database connected to the other two with their account information, personal information, all that jazz. So this can mainly be done through core data in Swift, but depending on, I don't know how big of the, I've only done like a very, very small database with that before, but worst comes to worst, we can also like try to build that into like an online database like through Bluehost or through some other kind of server. So depending on how we want to navigate that, we can like figure out how to scale that. But we have some options.
There's also the kind of like more optional side, like the goal here is to like have an e-commerce portion of the platform so that you can order food to the food trucks for pickup. Do you want to talk about
that? So, great thing about e-commerce applications is that this isn't like a new like groundbreaking thing. There's a ton of applications that are e-commerce built.
Yeah, plugins.
Yeah. So this isn't like groundbreaking. We're not trying to make like a new rocket ship or whatever. So through my research, that we could, there's both free tutorials on how to build like things, and there's also plugins you can pay for. So we have options. Like we have the quick, easy route, which is like pay for this plugin, get all like
the underground plumbing built for us without us having to work, and then we could just build the component on top of it, or we could try to build our own plumbing based on these free tutorials, most of which can be done through Swift, but it gets a little complicated because you have like money transfer.
I've done that. I don't want to do that.
Yeah. So from what I've looked at, it looks like it's a nightmare. Yeah. So there are a ton of like different plugins for it though. Like one that I found that seems to be pretty popular is Shopee.
Yeah.
So, building off Shopee is good.
It seems like the more difficult aspect of the e-commerce side would be the actual hardware involved. So, if we looked at the Pingo's platform, and we pretty much just like stole their printer. But the way this works for like mobile support in like food trucks is that you have to have an iPad for like handling everything. Most I think food trucks already have iPads because they're working through Square now, but that's going to take a lot of like research and like interviews to like truly figure out how the food trucks operate and how to integrate like e-commerce effectively with their workflow. So that's it. Thanks, guys. Questions?
Wait. Yes. Questions.
What was the question?
Yes. Declining guaranteed.
Yeah. We'll just say yes.
You were talking earlier about how there'd be info on like the popularity of the food trucks, like how many people go to this truck, how many people order what. Information public, or is that like not public?
So, do you mean like the user's individual personal information or the numbers?
I mean the numbers.
Okay, so yet.
Yeah.
Probably only for food trucks themselves. I'd probably like to keep it private in the database for them. Not entirely sure yet, but like if I thought like having columns to save like most popular items when people are ordering might be helpful, like for the food truck to run analytics of like what's most effective. But it's also like kind of unnecessary to actually like, core functionality we have.
Yeah. I was just thinking like less about the food item specifically and more food truck, and I saw that this truck, this location, was getting many more people than me, then I would go to that location and therefore sort of siphon customers off of the original food truck, which I assume is not something you guys would want to do, which is why I was just thinking that might be private, or even like not even a thing that you would look at. Yeah.
I think like locations of other food trucks would be private to the food truck. Like if you have a food truck account, you might not be able to see, like, so say you're the user account, right? You have two different accounts you have in this application. The food truck, the user. For the user, you can see where all the other food trucks are.
So let's say
I'm...
Why can't you have someone else who works at the food truck?
Have another user account. Issue if the popularity isn't an issue. I also think like the GPS aspect like almost seems like if you think about like what food trucks do, like food trucks already position themselves in locations that are like convenient for people. Like if you work at like a big company or whatever and you look up a food truck and it's right outside your door already because it's a food truck. And if you're looking for a specific food truck, like I think a lot of them already have either a GPS or
a website where
you have like, oh, on Wednesdays we're here. So I think the important thing is the Topingo aspect of it, because that seems like the most relevant functionality of
it. Well, the Topingo aspect on top of like just taking all that, so over the summer when I was at Coffee, I'd be like, hey, where's the Clover food truck? Not here. Like, I see all the people along my road saying Clover. But Clover's not, if Clover's three blocks away, I don't want to walk that far. If I still want something similar, you could search like vegan food and like get only the food trucks that are vegan food. Or one of the things we talked about for the account too is you could save if you have any dietary restrictions. So say if you are extremely allergic, you probably don't want a sushi truck. You can filter your search a little bit and only see relevant food trucks.
That
Let me ask you, even in big cities, is the number of food trucks that big where you have to search through them?
Yeah.
In DC it is.
Oh, okay. And
that's like, yeah.
I mean, a rodeo in Rochester is like how many trucks?
There's like 30.
30?
Yeah.
I think
it's more than 30.
Yeah.
The one on public markets,
I think
it's 40.
I took
a summer
course in, and there's literally like a whole line, yeah. Like a whole row. Yeah.
I guess I haven't been out and about in a while, because last food truck rodeo I went to had 4. Yeah. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. So I didn't mean to digress there, but those kind of user apps, I mean, excuse me for interrupting, but I mean, that kind of stuff, you know, you think of your user and context scenarios of like, I want to do fill in the blank, and you have a whole list of those different types of things, and then you pick and choose how many of those context scenarios do we want to actually build into our app and actually provide to users so they can do, like searching based on, you know, selections, allergens, and stuff like that. That's pretty good.
I think that's also part of the reason why we want to have a database for each truck with like menu items.
Ah, yeah.
And then from that menu item, we also have the ingredients list.
Mm-hmm.
Because as somebody with dietary restrictions, like trying to look up every website, trying to figure out what's in
one. And try to find their menu.
Yeah, it's pain. Like Panera, huge company. Website,
things
pain
out.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah.
No. It's
firm. Yeah. I have a question. So is the idea, like, honestly, like, I don't have a car and I don't like eat at like food trucks a lot, but is the idea, so people like would drive to like, so there's a food truck that sells Mexican food. I would drive there? Like, is that a normal behavior? Like,
I don't think people would drive to a food truck. I think people just walk there.
So
this is for like big city use. So it would not be that effective in Rochester. But Rochester is also not our target audience. Unless you're in like downtown Rochester and there's a food truck.
So the case study would be like, I'm in like New York City and like, you know, I'm like downtown, there's this like Mexican food truck and I would walk there.
Yeah, like I don't think you'd ever, like if I had a car, like I'd rather drive to like one of like the better restaurants versus the food truck. You know, like it's like just like a convenience. Like if I can walk.
Mm-hmm.
In a lot of major cities, especially like financial districts or districts with a lot of like offices, food trucks will tend to drive there and like camp out like, classic examples like Copley. Like during lunchtime, like Boston and Copley. Financial district, apologize. It's a big part. All the food trucks every day will drive out there and camp out.
Mm-hmm.
It rotates what food trucks go there each day though. Some people hit like Downtown Crossing on Thursdays, but it like rotates.
Mm-hmm.
So the idea of this application that say if I work in one of these office buildings, I can have my location hit the app, see what food trucks are downstairs outside before I go down. And I can decide if I want to go down there or if I want to like order food or go to the food court or all that jazz.
Yeah.
So many scenarios. When I was doing some contract work here, so not a great example, but still, there would be trucks, like 2 or 3, in the area, in different areas of downtown Rochester, and we would have to make a commitment. We're going to walk this way or that way based on who's there and always changes, obviously, too.
Rotates. Yeah, and like having this ability to have like see the greater Rochester area too, say if you're using it in Rochester or more than just like what's directly nearby, you can help the user make those choices. So for myself as a use case, if there are only like food trucks I was like kind of okay with right outside, but I saw like my favorite food truck was like 2 blocks away the other direction, I'd make that commitment and walk 2 blocks.
If you knew it was there.
If I knew it was there, I wouldn't want to like go walking through South Beach.
Yeah.
But like,
it's also a fitness app.
But also like having access to the menus of what served in each truck, I think is like the big thing.
There's other things too.
No, well, I think that like you have like two ideas here. Like you have the Tapingo idea and then you have like this idea of like finding food trucks. I think that like there's like I feel like there's not a moth vegan. Like I feel like that like the idea, like what if like a lady in that office building did like an email list and like she would email like, you know, and I feel like there's an easier way to like do that.
Like board marker. I think I want to show you how, like, I don't have something to show you here, but I want to show you how those two ideas fit together.
Yeah, no, and what I'm saying is, like...
There's no clip of windows.
Oh, yeah.
So I have a white
marker. I have a Sharpie.
But I think that, like, the Tapingo idea, like, the idea to order in advance, especially, like, I mean, I have, like, an hour to, like, eat lunch. I think that's, like, the most exciting aspect of this idea, because I think...
For you as a user, though. Like, that might not be the exciting idea for everybody as a user.
No, that's true, but, I mean, yeah, I'm speaking for myself, but, yeah, okay.
I actually disagree. I think they fit together sort of intuitively. Like, I think Tapingo works because... They're not moving. Like, Topanga still has when they're open, when they're closed, and it's kind of weird. Part of it is like, oh, part of the inconvenience of it is, oh,
I don't need to go because it's closed. But
food trucks, there's are open. Closed, but also don't want to be here. Like that.
Let me ask a question, because I know you want to draw a picture. But what's wrong with Tap and Go?
And can you not use it with food trucks, or they're just not using
just
it?
Campus.
It's Tap and Go is a.
You can also use it with money. Like I don't know if it, like they have like. I mean, I don't know if they actually like marketed towards food trucks, but I don't see.
No, yeah, I don't know why, and it's more than just here. I mean, and they're trying to market themselves to any restaurant or anything, you know.
Here's the thing: it's
like just. I want to get this out. I'm concerned that the e-commerce aspect would kill this idea. It is so complicated and complex, and then also you'd be competing with tap or not only just Tap and Go, but any e-commerce feature that a truck wants to use for themselves. You would be overlaying another one on there, and you'd have to convince them of it.
There are so many context scenarios for just finding the food truck. Finding the menus, finding the other things
too. I was thinking like finding like when you ever go to a food truck and it's like, holy shit, there's a line. It's, you know, I just walked two extra blocks to get to this one, but everyone else did too. I would love to know
before I got there, like how many people are queued up. I don't know if we
can do that, but
that's happened to me as well.
So, oh yeah, that's
well that's all only after the orders. But anyway, so these are all things, and that's more of just the social aspects of the community of food trucks, which has nothing to do with e-commerce, and there's so many things to do there. So I kind of want to,
Have you think more about that stuff, too, because I'm afraid of the e-commerce part.
I think that there's also, like, a lot of cases where food trucks wouldn't want, like, online ordering.
Yeah, I don't think they see that as an issue. Their bottleneck is making the food fast enough. Yeah. The ringing out part is like, they can do that pretty quickly.
So maybe we could have the e-commerce, having the online ordering thing be their later development or be optional.
Yeah.
So we have a beta with it.
And like I said, the core is the tracking and the menus. And then, like, if we're even gonna add the e-commerce, we're gonna do that after we do like a bunch of interviews and get a lot of qualitative data, so we like better understand like the niche we would be in.
Yeah.
Cause it might work well for like software.
First of all, were you gonna draw something really intriguing or?
No, like it, but the moment's kind of.
Okay. Sorry about that.
So I guess my biggest question is, there's like a lot of mints, and it's a very cool project. There's a lot of components to it. Who can do what?
Developer.
Yes.
Right. UX.
UX.
I'll be more background. I can just do my stuff later in this project.
Branding.
Michael's
a brand. That's pretty good.
Yeah. We got like 30 do mobile applications that we have the ability.
Yeah. So this too, obviously, in a different way, this is also very intriguing because, I mean, it's like there's such a groundswell of like, oh yeah, and I want you to do this and this and this. Everyone wants, there's the obvious need, which is also something as actually Gerardo, you brought up earlier, is when we first started talking about ideas, I kind of neglected, you know, let's find a good need first. And then, you know, I focused mostly on the technology to a fault. This is obviously the biggest need, and which is great because it kind of contrasts the other ones because we all want you to succeed. We want to use this app. So yeah, this is a good idea. The feasibility thing is still like, because you are so dependent on these weird people out there that own food trucks, you know, and that's a personality thing. And we heard from the seniors, who is following the seniors that were so dependent on like outside people. That became the roadblock. It's like, oh my God, there's these other people that are outside of the university that we're dependent on to be successful. You're kind of opening up, you know, the same thing. Now, they are small business owners, so they'd probably be more open to, you know, anything. We just want more money. So yeah, sure, get in here, but don't disturb me. That might be, you know, helpful. But it still is a concern, you know what I mean?
That's part of the benefit of having this is that we have we're not only trying to sell this to customers, we're trying to sell it to food trucks.
Yes.
So we have to like, when we first get like a test of the app, we have to like market, we can't just go out and be like, hey, you want to use our app?
Yeah, like, you gotta boots on the ground, you gotta walk out there and people have to, you know, develop relationships with these. Could be weird, creepy, you know, desperate business owners that have like banked their entire life savings on buying a truck that, you know, their parents are yelling at them and saying, Robert, that's a stupid idea. You should go to school and study computer science.
I was actually planning to graduate
from just
buying a truck.
Yes, but anyway, those people are still happy and they're happy with their choices. And that has nothing to do with anything. I think we're good here. David, take it over.
I just have one last question that I just kind of realized. You are selling it to food truck people, and like that's a big. I think there's a good sell to make there. You even just said it yourself, like this wouldn't work well in Rochester because there's not any food trucks. So once it's made, are you going to try to the food trucks in Rochester? Or are you going to like?
Well, I think Rochester is a good test case because it's small. Yeah. So it works well for like the public market food truck.
It just has to be enough.
Yeah, enough to like see it works, but like for scalability, like the division is like your Boston's, your DC's, your New York's. Doesn't mean every food truck in those areas, but it means if you can get like a good chunk of them using it, it could take off.
Yeah.
And I don't know. Yeah.
So that was your
idea. It could work. One thing, I don't know if it's still relevant, but in my old Xerox days, working in marketing, there was a list I saw of test cities. And for American cities, middle ground ones, was actually Syracuse was at the top of the list. For Syracuse University, if you want to, middle America, not literally middle America, but a typical American city to test a new product was like Syracuse University was like one of the like mecca of places where you should bring your product. And if it works in Syracuse, ironically, it'll work anywhere, which is so bizarre to say. And of course, Syracuse not so different from Rochester. Rochester was also on the list, pretty far up there, which is kind of, you know, which was why I remember it, because it was so bizarre, really, you know? But like McDonald's, and other, you know, all sorts of products would go do their testing in cities like this, and especially for some reason, Syracuse.
I think it works well too, especially with food trucks, because we have food trucks on the campus, like the campus communities already know, we already kind of have that in, being like, hey, we're your customers, we like your product, let's help.
We're a university, we're doing stuff.
Like, let us help you, help us help you because we want to use your product.
Help us help you help us. Okay.
Yes.
Exactly. Ooh, that sounds like a tagline, you know, because again, you do have to market to them too. Help us help you help us. All right. My marketing days.
Help them out the
yeah. That sounds like a lot.
My marketing days are over, thankfully. So anywho, thank you very much. I think we're all set here. Good job, everyone. So we're done for today. This was actually awesome that you guys did this. We'll by the way, so I already have some ideas about what we can do next week, basically following on more on this. And then I am going to still kind of push you guys to go back to the beginning and spit out like another idea, any other idea, which we just, you know, could either gravitate to or just say, no, we have already got some good ideas. I want to find that happy medium of, like, we truly have, we all feel like we fleshed out the best of our creative juices in terms of things that you might want to do in your senior capstone. Kind of rewind the clock a little bit next week and have you guys start thinking about other ideas that we haven't thought about. So till then, have a nice day, have a nice weekend, get on out of here.
Where do you see it?